much for you. Cheers. Awesome shit.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So welcome to Pokljuka, the men's 10-kilometre sprint about to get underway, and Felix Leitner from Austria will start the proceedings. Leitner, it hasn't gone all his way this season. Last year and his previous years, it was all about his shooting, but losing his way a little through the rifle, he's had a 44th, a 29th and a 16th in the three sprint races we've had so far.
So gradual improvement. Let's hope today he can gain another 10 places.
I like your positives. Gradual, that's all you need. So Benny Dahl, he did take third position, needs 0-0. He knew that in France, and he achieved that with a podium for the first time this season.
Yep, fifth overall in the Sprint World Cup Globe competition. So the sprint tends to be a good race for him.
Yes, it does. I think he's favoured. And, of course, world champion, when was it, 2019, down in Hochfilzen.
Very distinctive style. You can spot him a mile away.
Yes, he has. And that head, eventually, when he gets tired, the head rolls left and right. Zachna, biggest name from Estonia. His father before him was a top-class biathlete, now running the proceedings in Otepää and in Estonian biathlon. Rennie, it comes good in the relays. I think the single mixed relay, Estonia always believe in themselves there. So Vladimir Iliev, one of the older athletes, 35 now. And his best ever day, I remember it so well, 2019, he came second in the individual there at the World Championships.
Yeah, indeed. We can sometimes forget about how good Iliev is. You know, the Bulgarians don't tend to get that much of a mention, but he is an exceptional athlete. And the fact that he's still skiing pretty well, having been at it for so long, is all to his credit.
You mentioned Fabian Claude earlier. Yes, he's improved so much in terms of his shooting, which has taken him all the way up into fifth place, matching his start bid. Fifth place in the overall World Cup standings. Off he goes. He did take part, Ian, and you may have seen it in the Schalke Stadium, 50,000 spectators in a football stadium. They skied in and out of that football stadium, and he was teamed up with Simon.
Sensational, fantastic event.
Yeah.
Great to watch, great for all the spectators to get so close and feel the atmosphere.
Yes, and you get all that impact of the excitement and the snap of the rifle as they release the shots. Nedza Kubinets from Poland. Well, Poland are waiting to find another Sikora.
Yeah, it's been a while. Tomasz Sikora, probably now over 20 years ago, I think, was Poland's only, I think, maybe one or two world champions in biathlon over the years. Here's another rising superstar, Nicholas Hartweg. I'm excited about this guy, Mike.
Yeah, and also known as Nick Perry in his music life. So he's a musician, he writes his own songs. He's a top-class triathlete from his teenage years in London. He speaks perfect English, German, and French, I think it is as well.
Mike, he's like you. Remember the country and western days? Used to make a bit of money on the side, singing in the pubs. I think it's a good fallback career if biathlon doesn't work out. But it is working out very well for him.
Yeah, if only. Michal Sima, 30-year-old now, first of the Slovak athletes about to get underway. 89% hit in the prone shooting and 87 stance. So Sima is a very good shot, losing his time in terms of this aspect, the cross-country skiing. Well, this is a slog and up this hill. You know this hill so well.
Benny Dole makes it look harder than some of the others, doesn't he? But it's misleading. He is a very fast skier, very powerful, gets great weight transfer by using all of his body weight over that leading gliding ski. Here goes Jakob Fak. He's going to get the biggest cheer from anyone going out in the start.
Yes, and all the fans here, of course, they know him well, and they know his history, and his history is excellent with 8 wins. And I'll never forget the bronze medal in this event. Totally unexpected at the Olympic Games in Vancouver 2010.
He has that distinctive little back flick of his left foot as he changes his body weight over. Very, very easy to spot him at a distance.
So, yes, he certainly has. First, the Croatian athletes, Krešimir Rankovic. Only 2 starts this season, and both of them, he didn't qualify for the pursuit. Top 60 today, they make the pursuit race tomorrow. Michal Kretschmarsh, he was also taking part in the showcase event in the football stadium on the 28th of December. His shooting let him down on that occasion. He needs 10 out of 10 today, and I think he can place even as far as the top 5.
Yeah, he's a strong athlete, isn't he? But I often wonder about that event at Schalke. If you go during the Christmas period, sometimes you just need the rest. For others, it really lifts them and helps them with a little bit of positivity on their shooting.
Yes, and Fabien Claude, he was teamed up with, we mentioned it earlier, with Julia Simon. They took the win there. It certainly did Julia Simon no harm as she finished second yesterday.
She's on good form, isn't she?
Yeah, all round. Oh, good to see more of the track today. You can just feel the speed you're going to carry on this quite steep and right-hand descent.
Yeah, 2 hours ago, this was hard-packed, almost icy, and would have been a little scary to get round, especially if you had a rifle on your back. But it's softening up a little bit now, so these guys will be able to relax a little. I wouldn't say completely. Little bit of a chicane, so you've got to take it easy and not lose any free speed. There's lots of free speed out there, and get the line wrong and you lose it all.
Yes, Claude is a very good alpine skier. I thought he might carry a little more, create more energy into that long descent. Well, hopefully we'll see Johannes Tingespoor descending there, and we'll see maybe a little bit more compression on the outside ski. Sebastian Samuelsson, the first of the Swedes, 5th at the Olympic Games in this event. 8th year at the World Championships in 2021. He really needs to hit 10 out of 10, and I think this could be his podium moment for the season.
Yep, total score 9th in the world, sprint results 9th in the world. That tells you that this is an event he likes.
It's all about, shooting fast today. You've got to take an element of risk, haven't you? You've got to build your position fast, try to get the first shot released quickly. In around 13 to 15 seconds, as Alex Shishar gets underway. 87% prone, 93% standing. Shishar is one of those athletes who is better, one of the few athletes actually, about 12 of them in the field today, who shoot better standing than they do in prone shooting.
Jakob Fuchs. So he's using Skate One up this hill, and for someone who knows this course well, this is his home territory, it's unusual to see Jakob Fuchs doing Skate One as opposed to the more dynamic Skate Two that we talk about on a hill like that.
Yes, Ed, we're probably trying not to build up too much lactic acid early. David Zubil, third in the first race of the season. He hit the perfect 20 out of 20. That was the individual, the 20-kilometer. Well, has the Christmas break settled this great biathlete, Fionn Maye? I certainly saw his Instagram a couple of days ago saying he's back. He showed the race face and he said, I'm back. But I'm a little concerned. If you've had a flu virus after his last race before Christmas, that is unsettling. So first of the athletes, bib number one, as expected, Felix Leitner. Slight change of the sides there, Ian. One click anti-clockwise accounts for about 2.5-3 millimeters movement. So clearly the wind was showing between 2 and 4 kilometers an hour. So a breeze, and he's missed his second shot.
No. Ah,
mentioned at the start, his shooting has let him down this season, Leitner.
Yes. Look at that. Just watch the difference. I mean, if you can see, if we see it now, we'll see how much difference. Zero to two penalties. Benedikt Doll will be away 200 metres, 300 metres in front of Felix Leitner this early on in the race.
Ah, it's a positive start, Ian. So Benny Doll will be feeling he'll keep the same... very, very tough Skate Two up this climb out of the range. He'll keep this mechanically going, and he'll still realize, although it's wet underfoot, that this is an advantage for him going so early.
Absolutely. It might look difficult, and Benny Doll makes it look hard, but it's definitely the best conditions that any of the athletes are going to get today.
So Samuelsson, let's have a look at his time. The best time at this point is Fabian Claude, if I'm correct. Yes, it is 3:14. Iliev just into range now, setting up slowly. Iliev absolutely wants to nail these targets. So often he picks up penalties.
Oh, taking his time. It's not going well.
Fionn Maye is away. Can he come back to his winning ways? He found them last year at the Olympics and prior to the Olympics.
Fabian Claude missed his first shot, so the race starts to fall apart at the first visit to the range. Missed his first two, Mike.
Do you know what? Maybe the showcase event in Schalke Stadium has put him off. His shooting was very good on that occasion.
Body language was so negative there. Looks as if he's given up already, but he can't afford to, because we know the sprint is only half of a two... part race with the pursuit tomorrow, so he's got to push it, otherwise he'll get no chance in tomorrow's race.
Yes, and it puts that to start so badly, it really unsettles you. And what do you think? Will Claude adopt his shooting when he comes in for the stand, making sure he nails or at least tries to get all five stand?
Well, I hate to say it, Mike, but it looked like he wasn't pushing hard around the penalty loop there. Maybe that's a good thing, but yeah, you can't afford to throw this away.
Hartveig, 22-year-old, here he is, youth world champion. And Hartveig, 7 seconds deficit, that's okay, into the range.
Almost nothing moves when he cocks the rifle. So good, so good.
Yeah, very composed. And that positive information quickly getting flashed out into the forest. All the coaches on various parts will be passing on the positive information. And actually, Ian, he's pulled back 5 seconds with his rather quick time on the range.
Yeah, compare that with Benny Doll, and compare the difference in style. He looks like he's just on a warm-up session.
Yeah, fearsomely strong athlete, Hartveig, and another extremely strong athlete, Martin Ponsiluoma. His father before him, representing Sweden in cross-country skiing. I remember him well back in 1992 in Albertville. I think he came seventh as his best Olympic result.
Oh, Jakob Fuchs.
14 seconds, Ian. Normally he gets them.
Mike, he's got to push the pace these days. He can't afford to ski within himself and shoot well, because skiing within himself is just not quick enough.
Yeah,
against the best athletes today.
And he certainly has. He used to be one of these very methodical biathletes that never took risk on the range. He had to increase his shooting pace because of his slightly dropping off race pace, but it hasn't paid off to date. And there is the penalty loop. Have a look at the officials. Two on the left side, two on the right side, two at the top end of this penalty loop. Just counting their athletes, or all the athletes, in terms of how many penalties. That's all matched up later, and
yeah, it's very rare that anyone makes a mistake. But it's sometimes in the heat of battle, you know, you can, especially if you got three penalty loops, and sometimes you can ski around and think, have I done one or two? I can't remember.
Well, the brain does say if you've had a bad day, let's say four, and some athletes sometimes five, you go into a bit of a fog of anger. Critchmarsh, careful to the first shot, fast through the rhythm of shooting. Beautiful.
Good.
Well, Fionnmaye, 3.9. That's, I think, pretty much perfect, Ian. Last season, we may have seen him attacking a little more aggressively from the start.
Well, that's 3.9 against the likes of Guillaume Comel and Fabien Claude, not your Ligrids and Johannes Tingner's Bose. So probably add another, double that, probably, for these guys, this man.
Oh, this man, he is so focused. His shooting stats are incredible. Second in the world and barely off the podium. In fact, the last 11 races, he's only been off the podium once. We've had eight of those 11 this year, three from last year. What a vein of magical form. And that's with a new rifle stock created in the summer.
Indeed, yeah. First year was sensational. I mean, a mystery how he was so good. Second year, all the pressure fell on him and it didn't go so well. Now he just seems to be more mature, doesn't he?
Yes, he does. He's and increased his shooting pace. He's trying to pull back seconds on Johannes Tingner's Bo, who starts very, very soon. And he's analysed that if I shoot faster, I can at least gain 4 seconds each time in on Johannes Tingner's Bo. So what's Samuelsson going to provide today? So frustrating. In the small picture, it's Johannes Tingner's Bo exactly 1 minute behind Ligrid on the start list. How do you think that's going to affect Johannes today, Ian?
Mike, I think the fact that he starts 1 minute behind Ligrid doesn't help him until the last loop, because I think Bo will feel the pressure going into each shoot, knowing what's happening in the race ahead of him.
Yes, it'll be interesting. And maybe it'll put it, Ligrid will maybe try and push this early pace to put Johannes Tingner's Bo under a little pressure. So he's getting information from Jacomel, who's leading. That's an aggressive start from Jacomel. He's 4 seconds ahead of Fabien Claude. Stolder is also having a very firm start to his race. So, second off the Germans. Went very well for Benny Dahl, 5 out of 5. Can Zobel copy his countryman?
Can shoot well, often does, but hasn't shot a 0-0 in a sprint so far this year.
Jacomel there adjusting his sights, as we saw from, was it Benny Dahl? One or two clicks to the left.
Quite a high position, Strollier. The higher the rifle is, the more unstable it tends to be.
My apologies, I think I was calling him as Jacomel. Yeah, I do apologise, Strollier. Methodical. But one target miss. Jacomel should be in soon. So setting the fastest times on the track, the Italian. So Benny Dahl already in for his stand shooting. Don't think he did manage to, it's luck of the draw really, isn't it, to tuck in behind the fresher legs of a later starter. Big moment for Benny Dahl. 5, potentially, for a podium.
Oh.
Oh.
The crowd sharing my
pain.
My pain. Ah, come on, Benny, get out.
Get a move on. Yes, Brunellen, much improved season. Delighted for him. He deserves this. His personal best has come already this season. So, yes, Brunellen, that's a competitive exit. Fourth position as he leaves, but it's very tight there at the sharp end of the race at the moment.
Yeah, so much more pleasant turning left at that point than turning right onto the penalty loop. Look at Johannes Bo, Johannes Tingas Bo, skate two up here. He looks so strong and he's maintaining that ski speed as he plants his poles and transfers his weight. The skis are not slowing down at all. He's in good shape.
Look at that time, 7.5 already ahead of Jacamel, but where is Ligrid? 14 behind, so Johannes Tingas Bo is really smashing the pace. Fio Maye, has he found the magic that he had so many times last year? Yes, he has. 5 out of 5.
Yep, fairly quick, consistent. You can just sense, can't you? There's a positivity in his body language now. He said, okay, let's do this.
He certainly is. And Jacamel actually setting into the range. A really, really powerful time today, Jacamel. And 5 out of 5. So the Italian will be taking the new lead time. And it's by 12.5 seconds.
Oof.
So impressive. Well, Fio Maye last year we have just seen, I think, a little more dynamic moves throughout his body. Not quite back at the races yet.
No, that little bit of sickness he had over the Christmas period is going to take a little bit of time. Bear in mind, he'll have had plenty of rest, but he won't have got much training in.
This will be interesting. Christensen in relation to Johannes Tingas Bo, 1.5 kilometres. It's certainly not going to be the new lead time, but I think when Jacamel was 7.5 behind, he may well move into second place for Christensen. Let's have a look. Yes, he does. Not much in it.
So what's going on at the front, Mike, with Ligrid? He's 14 seconds down, I think, on Johannes Tingas Bo at that point, at this split that we saw here. As we stop just to watch Hartweg do his thing. Usually we can expect a clear.
That's the mind.
Hardly believes it.
Yes, he would say in his mind, yep, this is going well. The thought process would have changed, and that changes the tension through the trigger finger. Ponciloma, the worst possible start, missing the first one. And now the third.
So hard if you've grown up around cross-country racing being your thing. It's so difficult to switch, and Ponsaluma is the consummate athlete, isn't he? He wants to fight and race everywhere, and it's very difficult to ease off and prioritize the shooting.
Yes, back up to the 1.5. You're talking about Ponciloma there. It surprises me because on his day, and he won the sprint race here, this race at the World Championships on his day, and it's a 1 day in 10, he has an outstanding day.
Yeah.
And he can break the field. We saw that in the first race of the season in the individual. We didn't expect him to hit all of the targets on that day. He did, and he won the race.
Yep. I think the other athletes are scared of him because he is so fast.
Yeah. Here comes Jacqueline desperately trying to match up with Johannes Tingas Bo, but he's second place, 6.2 behind.
Come on.
That's his faster rhythm.
Yep. Okay, so he's already now, Mike, he's thinking about tomorrow's race.
Yes, damage limitation, missing 1 out of 5, first time in. It's still, Ian, it's still pretty good. And you can hear the spectators raising the levels of support big time. 6.8 seconds behind.
Chris Marr, zero on his prone. Can't afford a miss.
I always think back to that wonderful day in Korea at the Olympics when Kretschmarsh took the silver medal in this event. He hit 10 out of 10 on that occasion. Oh, he's done it again.
Yes.
Brilliant. So I can't do better in terms of shooting. No, Ligrid. This is unusual. His first shot missed. Well, what speed was that? Let's see if just try and get the speed of that particular shot. I think it was 24, 25 seconds.
Johannes Tingnesbo has taken up, already taken about 20 seconds out of Ligrid by the first shoot.
Incredible. Let's have a look. My computer's just switched out. So, building his position well. Has that firing pin snapping in his zeroing put him off? I hope not.
Absolutely. Identical range procedure before the first shot is released.
Ooh. So the race is on. Ligrid missing one. Johannes Tingesbo, he probably is aware that... No, he's not. He's not aware that Ligrid has missed one. He'll get that information soon. Well, I didn't expect that. So Johannes Tingesbo finding himself on the penalty loop. The same as Ligrid. Ligrid maybe a little unsettled with the fact that Johannes was putting in such, or is putting in such, a strong pace on the track.
Very good of Campbell Wright there to just indicate to Johannes, you know, I'm not going to get in your way, and letting him get past him as they left the penalty loop. Sometimes, I mean, this penalty loop particularly, we've seen over the years a few collisions of athletes have passed that point, but Samuelsson can't afford anything more than one miss today. Oh, why? Mike, your reaction said it all there. Why did he rush that last shot?
Panic, isn't it? There's an element of, I've got to get this down. And it was almost fear. You know, when you get that, oh, it's just the last shot. You think, oh, I've got to get this. He panicked and he missed.
Yeah, sometimes you see the sight picture and it looks like it's there, so you snatch it. But by the time you've operated the trigger, it's moved. Much better to just stick to your routine, let the rifle drop onto the target and take the shot.
Could this be a Christensen day? He's into the range, only 10.6 behind Johannes. Needs this one. Could this be the new lead time? Although Johannes Tingesbo is only 8 seconds behind Jacomel's time. And Jacomel hit all five targets in the prone. But it is the new lead time. Christensen. This will really feed into his mind now, Ian. Will need to keep the pressure on. He knows that Johannes Tingesbo is in great form on the track.
Yeah. Christensen will have looked around and think, who are the people that I need to beat today? And two of them, right at the top of his list, are not having a good day. So he'll be feeling confident, which actually means he's really benefiting from the start that he had in group two.
Yes, he is. Here comes Benny Doll. So bib number two coming into the finish of the race. Give us a good indication, this. Unfortunately, he did miss one target. And so we will expect this time to be bettered by some at least 30 seconds. 24:59.2 at the moment is the lead time. You know that feeling well.
Pain.
It's pure and simple pain, isn't it? So, Jesper Nellen. Much improved season, as I said, when he came in for his prone shooting.
Jackalan in for his first prone or first shoot.
He takes it. There's a lot of movement in Jackalan, just building the position. The right elbow slips out a little, but when he's there, he's there.
Oof. No.
Oh, two targets missed for Jackalan.
Mike, it looked like the first two shots looked disciplined. They looked like they were in the right rhythm. And then the third shot went way too early. And then the next two shots just fell out. It was almost as if he lost it completely.
Incredible. So, Jesper Nellen, the perfect 10 out of 10. It's a great feeling when that happens. And he'll be, I would imagine, he's feeling energized with the positivity of 10 out of 10. Jacomel. His best start to a sprint race this season. Missed the second. Jacomel, I was watching the graphic from Phil Myers there, who isn't quite at the races yet. Jacomel missing two. What a pity.
On current ski speed, Mike, we possibly see Jacomel go past Phil Myers on the penalty loop. He's moving to the side. He wants to get past him because he's on good form, but... He's got to go around this loop twice, and Fionn Mayer's only got the one to do.
And Fionn Mayer, last season we would see a much increased dynamic movement. Does he realise Jacques Hamel is going round again? Well, it doesn't interfere with him. It's still pretty good though, Ian. 7.8 behind, missing one. It's okay. It's early in the race, but that is okay.
Yeah, right now he's trying to work out what does he do? How does he minimize the loss in order to have a good start in tomorrow's pursuit? We know, I think it's fair to say, if you're starting within a minute of the leaders in a four-shoot race like the pursuit, you can still win. And he'll have already been told, Mike, that Bo and Liegrid haven't had it all their own way today either,
yes,
so far.
Yes, and that is a big factor. But, of course, we'll go back to the first shooting bout. And, it's Christensen leading, Jacques Hamel second, but we saw him miss. Here comes Tarja Boer. That's better. Tarja Boer coming into the range. It's a good time. 24 behind is seventh position. So Hartweg, the talented youngster from Switzerland, we saw him miss one. And 45 seconds behind Benny Dahl. So Tarja Boer picking up a little time on the range, finding himself 17 seconds behind Christensen. Another Norwegian, and in fact, the second last to start. It's Philip Fjeld Andersen. Timofey Lapshin, the former Russian athlete for Korea, in the small screen. He's been shooting slightly slower this year, Ian, but managing, by that process slowing down, he's managing to quite often get all of the targets.
Yep. Discipline. Ponsaloma, we saw shooting there, but hasn't gone well in the first shoot, so he's going to be behind time. And we know what happens with Ponsaloma. He ends up pushing it to try and make up for it, and it tends to go the other direction.
So Roman Riis, I was just about to big him up, his chances, but he's missed the first shot. He was into the stand shoot in third place. This looks like Kretschmarsch.
Oh, it's going to be so close.
And that's missing it. Sorry, that's hitting all 10 targets compared to Benny Dahl, who missed one. So Kretschmarsch losing a little on that last lap, possibly pacing there, attacking two. He was setting some good times early on, but fatigue clearly on the final lap.
Yeah, he's a big guy. It's difficult to see, but there's a lot of muscle on Kretschmarsch, and those hills don't favour heavy athletes. And there's a little bit of altitude here to take into account as well.
There certainly is. On the track, here comes Liegrid. I was just looking at Johannes Tingesbo running in second place, but closing down effectively on Christensen's time. Liegrid has done very little wrong. Off the podium once in only the last 11 races. That's including last year.
Yep.
Fast as well, each shot practically under 2 seconds. And there's Johannes Tingesbo already, so he's pulled a lot of time back on the track, Johannes Tingesbo.
Yeah.
Ah, how good is that? Liegrid 5 out of 5, Johannes Tingesbo 5 out of 5 standing. They really are pushing the limits, but it's massive advantage now to Johannes Tingesbo.
Yep, one penalty loop in the whole race. If you'd pick 2 or 3 athletes who could miss one and win the race, Johannes Tingesbo would have been on that list.
Yeah, quite incredible. Liegrid, I saw on Monday, he was just putting a photo of him, putting his rifle back into his car in Norway, saying, yep, that's it, done and dusted. Oh, sorry, it was Sunday, last of the Christmas preparation over. So I thought, yep, he's feeling good. Hmm. The shooting, we know, is always good. But he's off, he's some 38 seconds off the pace to Johannes Tingesbo coming into that stand shoot.
That's a big margin for Liegrid.
It is. Yeah. So clearly, maybe that interval training was, or the intensity over the Christmas break was just a little too high.
Yeah. I mentioned the altitude here. It's only, I think, 1,300, 1,400. Not huge, but if you don't accommodate that and don't prepare for it, it can catch you out. And different people react differently to this kind of the higher, thinner air.
They do. Christiansen, he knew he was in second place coming into, sorry, leading coming into the range. He was 2.8 seconds ahead of Johannes Tingesbø. What a mess.
Oh.
What a mess. That is so unlike Christiansen. And, well, at least he's not looking angry. There's like a smile of what happened there.
Yeah, yeah. I think sometimes we can forget that sport is about playing and having fun, and I suspect he's decided he's going to just try and have fun. There's going to be a lot of pain for the next 6 or 7 minutes, but...
Incredible. Yeah. I find that quite incredible, but it's really changed the shape of the race. So Johannes Tingesbø leading by 35 seconds after the second shoot, and he's ahead of Timofey Lapshin, who's second, 35 behind. Lagrid, although 37 behind, is still third position.
Mike, we often see it, don't we? If Bo shoots a zero in the sprint, he gets a massive cushion going into the pursuit. It looks like today he may end up with a huge cushion, but only because most other people, unlike the women yesterday, most other athletes are shooting poor.
It's surprising. On a perfect shooting day, just Jacomel getting the information on it, and it's pretty good. It's pretty good, but we must remember that that's chasing Benny Dahl's time. And Benny Dahl is ranked now sixth after the range, the second shoot. So we have to take that into account. Yes, Brunellen, another good race. Anybody that hits 10 out of 10 on a regular basis, he's doing that now. It's very, very top end biathlon. He seemed to back off quite to the line. Every athlete's always pushing to the line, but exhausted. So yes, Brunellen just crossing in fourth position. Phil Maillet looking like he may well be chasing that fourth position. In fact, I think he'll take a new, or he'll come into fourth position, dropping Nellen down one.
I like the way he's skiing, Mike. There's something about the way Phil Maillet is skiing. The fitness might not quite be there, but he looks very confident on his skis. I love the way he took those corners. Didn't lose any speed, and in comparison here to Jesper Nellen, you can see him pushing right to the line.
Yes, well, he said not only has he moved forward of Nellen, he's just managed to drop Jakob Fak down, so a really, really strong end to his race. Jacomel, it looks so good, it's still very good, and will slot in ahead of the great Phil Maillet, but that is going to drop as the big names come through.
But that's astonishing to be ahead of Phil Maillet, having done an extra penalty loop, an additional penalty loop, and you can see when they left the range, or when they left the firing point, he had 150 metres extra to ski, and by the time he got to the finish, it was probably more like, I don't know, 40, 50 metres.
It was Lapshin just, I think, is he getting, yes, he's getting the split times, and it's not good news. He left the range in second place, and now then he dropped to third place at 8.2. He's in fourth place now, just outside those important podium positions, and I think he'll drop back further.
Yeah, indeed, that body language suggested a body full of lactic acid.
Bionats, I was just about to praise him there. He's now picked up one penalty, is still okay. And Tarja Bo now, older brother of Johannes. Can Tarja hit these five? He needs to get his season back on track.
Could be a podium.
Wow, that would be so good. Again, they have done it many times, the Bo brothers on the podium. But always the younger brother, slightly higher up.
So he's probably easily capable of out-skiing Lapshin, who's in second position at that point.
It is. He has Johannes Tingis leading, his older brother is second, 31 behind as he left the range. Oh, look at his ski time.
Oof, that is so impressive.
Ah, that's incredible. So he did, I think he got the information there, and his brother is in second place. That might just create a little bit of that positive feeling that you need to take the pain away, and maybe he can push just a little harder. Lapshin couldn't push any harder, and sadly on the journey over the last 3.3 kilometers, he really has dropped down the ranking. Left the range in third place. And crossing the finish line in fourth place. But as he exited the range, the Boer brothers were ahead of him, so he's likely to drop down quite a bit more. Roman Rees missing just one. And they're quite close, aren't they, the German athletes here at the front? 14.6 separating them.
Yep. Looks like they could be able to put in a fairly strong team. A couple of teams, actually, on Sunday.
It does indeed. So Johannes Tingisbo, skis are clearly running well.
Look at that. So good. He's so all over it, isn't he? He's got plenty left. This is hurting, but he's able to push.
Well, it was 51.6 ahead of Ligrid. I think he might be punching this up to 58, 59 seconds advantage on Ligrid. And he'll be just wishing that there were more athletes that could get in the way or in between the two of them. Here comes Ligrid now. Well, Johannes passed him. Of course he did. 55 behind. That's incredible.
Wow.
That is incredible skiing. So at the moment, Johannes Tingisbo leading the way. He knows that's a win today. Nobody can touch that performance. 55.6 ahead. And that really does set him up well for tomorrow's pursuit competition.
Mike, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that means Bo is the first World Cup male athlete to win the first four sprints.
That is correct. Well, Johannes Tingisbo, the race hasn't finished yet. He's crossed the line, but there's nobody, just nobody out there who can touch him now. Ligrid finds himself 55.6 seconds behind. I say there's no one can touch him. There are athletes who can challenge for the podium, and Johannes Dali is one of them.
Not rushing, needs a zero, can shoot a zero.
Johannes Tingisbo will be very interested in this performance. Ooh. He could have got in between Johannes and Ligrid. That would have gained a few more points on the season's grand total score for Johannes. But he missed the last shot.
Yeah, he could have been doing one teammate a favour and upsetting the schedule for the other.
He could have did. It's going to be such a strong performance again for the Norwegian athletes. At the moment, it's one and two, and when Tarje Bo comes in across the line, it'll be one, two, and three positions for Norway. Can Pep Femling create a surprise? He needs five. Actually, the clock is pushing on, isn't it? He may not get exit in sub... Well, you need to exit in sub 35 seconds. And that time has passed. Ah. Well, what happened there?
Yeah.
Just all over.
It's worth pointing out, Mike, as we watch some of the later starters now in getting into their race. Actually, let's just see how... Christensen won over a minute behind at this point. I mean, skiing pretty fast given that he's had three penalties, but...
Oh, it's painful, isn't it, Ian? Christensen came in on the day, the fastest time into the stand shoot, having hit five out of five, and he missed three targets. Total meltdown. There'll be a deep analysis of what happened. He'll just try and relive that moment, find out what happened. So Christensen, from leading into the second shoot, down into 10th position at the moment. That will drop further.
So Talking about analysis then, Mike. I mean, I think you said it there, leading into the second shoot. I think he possibly overcooked it on that second loop, which of course means you have less to put out there on the last loop, but it also means that you put yourself under more pressure going in for that harder stand shoot.
And you know, he would have been aware how good his day was going. He would have received that information. Come on, Tarja Burt. Delighted to see him back and sharp. And let's say the last time check, Ian, Tarja Burt was still ahead of Lagerud by only 8 seconds, so he needs to keep this firm.
Yeah, skiing well there, Mike. He's a loop ahead of Simoneda, who, you know, he's a form athlete, Simoneda. He constantly performs well, little older now than in his heyday. But then Tarja Burt's no spring chicken either. And Tarja Burt, on his last loop here, is managing to stay ahead of him, having skied an extra 3.3 Ks by this point.
Yeah, interesting that. So he's still 8 seconds. Patrick Oberegger given the exact timings there. You always need exact timings and clarity in terms of the timings being sent to you in that storm of a race that you're in.
It's interesting to note here, Mike, all the athletes are seeing now there's no sun on the range. When you're zeroing earlier on in this race, for this race at this venue, you have the sun that starts behind you, swings around to your left, so it's coming into your left eye. Now, I don't remember what the sun was like for the women yesterday, but if they had a little bit of cloud cover while they were zeroing, it would mean that they'd have exactly the same conditions for the shoot going into the prone shoot as they had for the zeroing, whereas the men had to cope with two different conditions.
Yes, it is a big factor, and the sun does come into your left eye on this range, doesn't it? They've been aware of that the last, 3 days now of access to the range and training. And I'm so happy for Tarja Burt. The season hasn't gone his way, or the way he was hoping. He's had a 50-30. He's had some bad days, and 18th position, 16th, 14th, 15th. So he really needed this today. And touching on the podium will secure himself into the team. He's such competition from behind the World Cup team athletes. I'm sure he was never a risk of being knocked out, but here he is today, finishing in second place behind his younger brother once again.
That will make them both extremely happy.
Yes.
And mum and dad.
Oh, big time. And Benny Dahl still holding on. We said Benny needs 10 out of 10 today to push for a victory. He wouldn't have actually got a victory, but at the moment, he's fourth place.
Excellent.
Now, could Simon Eder, you mentioned, he's still on form. He's 39-year-old. He'll be 40-year-old just after the World Championships. And this is a absolutely season best so far.
Yep, 53 seconds behind. But remember, most of that is Tarja Burt's huge margin.
47. So all he needs to find on the positive is 1 second to reach up to Kretschmar's place, and then Lagerud is only 10 seconds ahead of that, but that is a tough challenge.
Mike, Lagerud looked tired. He looked slightly off balance to me on that last loop, couple of the corners. Didn't look like he was relaxed. And that's not Lagerud's normal style, is it?
No, he certainly looked less dynamic today, less forceful on this section of the track. As Philip Fjell Andersen comes in, those great Norwegian biathletes really are filling in the slots. Certainly in the top 15 and taking all the prizes at the moment, the top three positions. So Philip Fjell Andersen missing one target. Let's take that away. He still would not have reached the podium with a perfect 10 out of 10. So welcome back, and well, some of the later athletes still haven't yet reached the range. 93 starters today, and Johannes Kern is not having a very good time with his 5 shots prone shooting. Well, what is going on? Certainly the German team here is the last of the German athletes. They came into the first World Cup, Ian. I thought the preparations had been excellent. They all performed well, with Zurbo medalling, Roman Rees taking a medal, but they seem to have lost their way, especially in terms of shooting. So Philip Horn is disproving that losing their way in shooting, but very purposeful, 31.3 seconds. So losing some 7 or 8 seconds on the fastest on the range.
Yeah, I think he probably outskied Johannes Kuhn going into that shoot, and he'll be leaving the range ahead of him because Kuhn's obviously still on the penalty loop.
Just looking further down, some of the results, Ian, any outstanding? Rastoguyev's unusually hitting 10 out of 10, but the day he does it, he's certainly a top 20, top 10, top 5 athlete, but at the moment he's in 18th position. Ponce Loma, the world champion from here 2 years ago, down in 19th, missing three. And Johannes Dahle, 128 behind. So the Norwegians really are peppering those top 15 positions.
Yeah, you mentioned Rastoguyev. I mean, he'll be chuffed that he had a zero today, but to be almost two minutes behind Bo, having not had to visit the penalty loop once, for someone of Rastoguyev's skiing speed, is just shows you what an incredible athlete this guy is.
I'm so impressed. Yet another victory. So 5 victories from 8 races leading into the Christmas break. Many were saying, will he lose that momentum, that mental focus? And the evidence today is absolutely not.
Yeah, there are several scripts, aren't there? You're going back into World Cup 4 after the Christmas break. One of the scripts says Bo's been under pressure. He's been at the front and then he loses it and he drops back. and the perfect script is that he breaks a record and becomes the first man to win all 4 sprints. We're talking about the first 4 sprint races at World Cup standard in the year, and he's right at the top. So far, he's only missed 2 targets.
And you know, the size of that, it's never been done before. That's the size of the achievement in terms of World Cup racing. And to keep so mentally strong. I thought when we saw, 40 minutes before the race, his firing pin snapped halfway through, I think it was the second bout of 5 shots. He looked, when your pin snaps, it's unbelievably frustrating. It's about, 5 to 7 minutes to get it put right. He looked rattled there, but obviously kept his calm and found his winning ways within the race.
So just to be clear, Mike, let's just say it. Olainer Bjørndalen didn't win the first 4 sprints. Who else?
Martin
Fourcade didn't win the first 4 sprints. I mean, To pull this off in the sprint race is so incredibly difficult. The margins are usually so tight, the pressure is so great.
Yeah, it's incredible. You've got the wind days, you've got snow condition days, you've got personal pressure days. So much is going on, and he really is at the top of his game again. 6 wins now from 9 races speaks for itself. Can he equal the 16 victories he took? What was it, 3 seasons ago? He was pushing hard, trying to beat the great, as he called him, the big bad wolf, Martin Fourcade. But this year, it's the big bad wolf is Ligrid, so Johannes again is having to dig so deep because he's got another seriously good athlete that doesn't have a bad day.
Well, I'm just wondering whether the big bad wolf for Bo will eventually turn out to be Bo this season. Can he continue to produce at that extraordinary level?
Well, Emil Nyqvist, it's okay. He's learning his trade at World Cup, and that's another good day. Simon Eder. Well, oh, there he is. I was thinking, oh, dear, it's not going well in the last lap. But it is. It's okay. He has lost a lot of time from the range. He left the range in 7th position, now down to 14th.
Okay, so let's just disregard Johannes Tingnes Bo for the moment, and now we're looking at second and third place, which is important for tomorrow's race. To get onto the podium, Simon Eder needs to finish today within a minute of second and third place.
Yes, and I suppose in his mind he'll be... You know, that will be the information he's getting as well.
Yeah, and the coaches will no longer be giving him splits on Bo because that's almost irrelevant now. They'll be trying to get him to think about how... I mean, he's not on the podium today. It's all about tomorrow's race. And I just wonder, Mike, what your thoughts are just on the fact that the sprint is almost always half of a two-race format with the pursuit following the next day. You have a bad shoot to start with, as most of the guys did. Do they then push harder? Or do they ease off in order to minimize the damage and make sure they have a good stand shoot?
Yeah, I think we've seen a couple of athletes today in the pro missing one. Slightly more care taken in the standing because it is vital tomorrow. Tomorrow afternoon, you're starting in that deficit time. So there's definitely a little mindset where you need to keep that focus strong. Interesting to see Lombardot, his first race of the season in the World Cup team. He has been brought in previously. Here comes Simon Eder, left the range in seventh position, fighting for a top 15. I think he's going to make it. He does, 14th position.
Yeah, good. So he's about 50 seconds behind Taribo, and that puts him in a good position for tomorrow's pursuit.
It does, especially with the way that... of course, that Simon Eder shoots. Incredible new record for sprints from the start of the season on the program. And nobody's going to touch him today. There are still athletes out there, but this is the man who is on magical form. His firing pin snapped and zeroing. I thought it would put him off. Maybe it did for that one shot. But even with that one shot, he's managed to destroy the rest of the field by 48.1 seconds. We really are looking at an athlete that is that took a break after the Olympics. He said, I've just done 10 intense years and I haven't really had a break. Yeah. And that really has set him tall for this season.
And we saw last year how tired he got towards the end of the season and the year before that, actually. It's a tough, tough routine, this World Cup circuit. And as we see Ligrid finish there, you know, it didn't go well for Ligrid. Johannes Tingnes almost caught him.
Incredible.
To be able to be on his tail going into the final loop. He knew he'd won. He knew no one else could catch him, but... I wonder, you know, the rules state that every single race, the points will count towards the World Cup this year. Johannes Tingnes Bo is possibly the only athlete who can get to the point this year where he can afford not to have to do every race and still win.
Possibly. But he still has that for him, that irritation that once again, Ligrid is on the podium. This is the 12th. From 12 races, he's only been off the podium once. We've got another man who is consistently brilliant to be on the podium. Johannes has been off the podium once this season, but he has had 6 wins.
Yeah, astonishing.
And we see the champion that he is, Johannes Tingnes Bo, but it must give a big shout-out for the... young New Zealander, just picking up on his position. Campbell Wright has had a wonderful race. I know he's the audience in New Zealand are watching right now. 30th position, missing one target. Delighted to see his form is back. He lost his way a little towards Christmas, but he's back again. And at 20-year-old, that is fabulous.
He's a great young lad, isn't he? That's fantastic news. And he's slowly creeping up, seems to be doing everything right. He's learning his trade and getting used to competing at this highest level.
Well, Philip Horn, he really needed 5 out of 5 again. And his time would have been challenging, actually, for a podium even. But unfortunately, with that knowledge, one target, one shot went astray. And his teammate ahead of him, they were the last of the German starters, Johannes Kuhn. And Philip Horn, well, the positive, Philip Horn will be able to see Johannes Kuhn and trying to close down in terms of track time.
I think we saw Simoneda finish around about 1:34 off the pace, is that right?
It was 1:34,
something like that. So maybe 3 seconds behind Philip Horn's current time. So if Philip Horn can manage to hold that position, he'll move ahead of Simoneda.
David Zingerle, his father for so many years was a biathlete for about 18 years. And then he's been on the telescope for Italy for the next 18 years and just gave that responsibility over into this new season. Ah, and David really has been a good shot on the IBU Cup. That's why he's been brought in, but he just let it slip, let it go there on the last single shot of his race. So Johannes Tingesbø, many were saying the pressure will start getting to him, that Lycrid just doesn't have bad days, and it's bad days are a third place Lycrid, as it was today. Will it get to Johannes Tingesbø? The evidence after Christmas is not at all. They both missed one today, and that came in the first of the five shots in prone shooting. The skiing was impeccable. The power from start to finish was there. And the desire is still burning so bright, even after the Christmas break. He loves getting back to his family. Everybody does, but he just loves that comfort. And he's recharged now after the Christmas break. Clearly delighted with the way the skis were running. It's not just the ski brand. I did wonder, we didn't see them congratulating each other. It wasn't a hug or a chat about the race. It was just business. And it's a serious business. So happy for Tarje Bø to take second position today, just yep. Ahead of Lygrid.
Serious business is the family business, Mike.
It is.
Nykvist, not a bad race in terms of shooting, but you know, those big numbers ticking away on the clock, all made look so much worse by the fact that the great champion Johannes Tingnes is 50 odd seconds ahead.
It's quite amazing. We often say, and Johannes has admitted himself, you know, sometimes going into a pursuit competition with such a lead, it changes your thinking. It's there's a lot more to lose. It stacks up to be somehow more pressure.
Yeah, the only way to get over that is to practice, but you've got to do it in order to practice. So I suppose he's doing just that, Mike. He's probably had more practice at that than anyone else.
He certainly has, and he has had it this season, where I think it was some 43 seconds advantage. It's 48 tomorrow. But significantly, he's 55.6 ahead of Lygrid. And then behind Lygrid, actually, there's a lot of traffic. So Johannes will be hoping that Fionn Mae, Giganaar, Johannes Dahle, Christensen can all pull some time back and get in the way.
Do you mean get in between Bo and Lygrid?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. For the points issue.
For the points. Well, here's the two Germans. Did say that Horn had a target ahead, if you like, on the track, and has just now passed his teammate Johannes Kuhn. 71 just cornering there. That's Paul Schommer. And the best of the American team just get an update at the finish line on the best of the Americans. At the moment, it's Doherty in 37th position. Jake Brown, 42nd position. So Dombrovski, Doherty 37th. Actually, it's going to be quite close to Doherty's time, 35th. So two positions taking that title as the best American, taking it away from Doherty.
Lombardo, zero. in his first visit. A new name, relatively new on the French World Cup scene. Shooting fast.
Well, yeah. You saw that look, didn't you?
Yeah.
I can do better than that. There was anger there. There was everything, all the emotions in there. I can do better than that.
Yeah. Braunhofer, good shoot. 0-0, 2:29 behind. Interesting to see with Bo's astonishing speed today what the 60th place finish time will be, how far behind the leader. We usually say it's about 2.5, 2:40. It's going to be more than that today.
Much more, I think, Ian, isn't it? Normally, actually, we see, depending on the conditions and the courses, between 10, 2:15 to 2:35 behind. Actually, today, you have to be 3:36 behind to make the top 60. So, Johannes Tingesbo, another victory, sixth in this new season from 9 starts. Fio Maye, many expected, would be back at the races, but I do think the setback over Christmas, the flu virus, has set him back. He's 9th today. And Ligrid, his bad day, if we can call it a bad day, didn't seem quite as strong on his skis, but he's still on the podium. Well, the eye of a champion. Standing was purposeful. He missed one in prone shooting. As it happens, he could have afforded actually a miss in the stand and still won. But he got them all. And a very happy Norwegian in Slovenia. So the men's pursuit, Johannes Tingesbo ahead of his older brother Terje Bo. And Ligrid in third place. Philip Horn has managed to break away from Johannes Kern. He's passed him. There he is behind. Oh, I got it wrong there.
Yeah, I think they've swapped places.
Was that a fall?
He's looking tired.
So Philip Horn still a little way to go. His time at 1:40, still a way to go. So he's certainly looking that he will slot into tomorrow's race and will finish today probably in the top 40. Yes, safely in the top 40. And his teammate just ahead of him, who started 30 seconds at the beginning of the day, 30 seconds ahead of him. So Philip Horn comfortably, actually, it's better than I thought, into 29th position. So Philip Horn's day is done in 29th position. And what a day it's been, especially for the Norwegians. Ligrid, you could say, had some misfortune selecting the bib or being drawn the bib 1 minute ahead of his main rival, Johannes Tingesbo. Ligrid missed 1 out of 5, prone shooting, very firm, very focused in his stand position. Didn't seem to be at the races in terms of his ski time. A little stiff, a little tired coming up the giant climb. And in the background, Johannes Tingesbo, who started a minute behind, slowly but surely tried to haul him in and managed to achieve all but, just under 5 seconds of that minute. Terje Bo starting later. The conditions were beginning to fade, the sun and the warm conditions on the track. He shot the perfect score in terms of prone shooting. Fearless, rapid fire in the stand and gaining some time in terms of that incredible 20.9 seconds from stop to start on the range, pulling a little more time back out of Liegrid and surviving, fighting so hard on the track. For once again, I think for the sixth time in their careers, the Boer brothers will share a podium. It's incredible. And none of those times has it been the other way around, where the younger brother it was below the older brother. So Tarje Bo today having to settle for second. Johannes Tingesboer, his main rival, 1 minute ahead. He had the misfortune of a snapped firing pin during zeroing. Really will unsettle most biathletes. Maybe it did. He missed one out of five in the lying down, the prone position. Round a penalty loop and back to business on the track. The form is incredible. He really is a step above the rest today in terms of his skiing speed. Forcing the pace. There's Liegrid just ahead of him, struggling his way across the line, knowing full well that the great Johannes Tingesboer was closing in. Liegrid third, and Johannes Tingesboer for his sixth victory this racing season from nine races. What a run of success. Johannes Tingesboer winning once again. Good to see another Swedish name coming into the proceedings. Plenty of support on the track. Stefansson, bib number 88 from 93 starting today. As the day and as the sun begins to drop down, what a race, Ian.
Yeah, I see the spectators, they're all, we can see them out there, can't we? They're starting to skip around because the temperature's dropping again. Probably not enough, really, for these athletes to benefit. The start of their race would have been the slowest conditions. And those corners, look at that, that is tough. Your legs are already screaming and you're working very hard to balance going around those tough, deep, slushy snow corners.
And it's interesting with the warmth here as in this incredibly strange season. It was 15 degrees on Monday here, and the day before the race, and it's difficult. Well, and we could hear the tightness, the icy conditions under the skis, and then all of a sudden you're into the dip we saw, where it's very mushy and wet, and you have to really brace yourself.
That's right. If you're not ready for it, it can catch you off guard. And we've seen, think back to the days of who was it? It was Olaine Bjørndalen crashing out on the last loop and losing the race. These corners took him out.
They did, the great man that he was. And just that very change in snow conditions. Stefansson across the line. That's a good outing from Stefansson. But frustrated that targets were missed. Lombardot is very good in terms of his alpine, his cornering skills. And as a French athlete, you get plenty of encouragement. You can't rest. They're on the top of the next hill. This is attacking skiing.
Yeah, it looks pretty dynamic. There's plenty of energy left.
Do you think that's punishment for the
quite possibly
the first and the fifth shot missed in standing?
Yeah, Mike, quite possibly. You know, it's like, oh look at that. So, unfortunately, lost all his speed. Fortunately, stayed on his feet. Otherwise, he'd have lost 20 seconds before the finish here.
And you know, when you're brought in from the IBU Cup, you get one chance. Or, yes, you're going to stay the whole World Cup. One chance of a weekend of racing.
That's true.
You really want to impress the coaches, or you'll be returned to the IBU Cup.
That's so true. Certainly with the French and Norwegians. But, you know, we look at the likes of Tarje Bo coming second today, and that helps him because there are so many young Norwegians snapping at his heels on the IBU Cup, doing really well. And Tarje needs to get in those podiums in order to maintain his position at the top of the Norwegian tree.
It is vital. And Lombardot, you heard him, the exhale there. The frustration, and that was the frustration from not getting it where he in IBU Cup, he is hitting 10 out of 10. He's been shooting very well. He let two go, and, well, what could have been? It could have been certainly a minute faster, and that would have put Lombardo, I'm just checking, a minute faster, and he'd have been a fabulous position, around the 15th position. So he's a very good biathlete.
Yeah, 15th, and being one of the last starters as well, that you can take off another maybe 20 seconds for the conditions.
Fair comment, and maybe even more, Ian. It's that, in terms of pace, you're on ice, and then you're in the slush. So you have to be aware all the time.
And difficult to get the wax and the ski structure right for the varying conditions on that hard-packed, still cold snow. With a flat surface, you want one structure, one type of wax, and on this slushy, wet stuff, you want another. So it's a trade-off. It's a little bit like whether you go on slicks or groove tires in a Formula One race.
That's so true. As Gizek comes in, he's also missed two targets, bib 91 from 93 athletes in the race today. You can just feel how exhausted he is, and actually he's just going to be outside the top 60 in terms of seconds. It's not that far. Positions down in 77th, the important 60 cutoff to make the pursuit competition tomorrow. His teammate did made it. Kubinets, he didn't. I'm looking at 69. It's Patriuks from Latvia, who's in 60th position, 3 minutes 23 behind.
Yeah, it's worth pointing out, for some of the lower nations, there's a race within a race here to finish in the top 60 to have a chance to race in the pursuit race, because obviously it's, you know, the cutoff, the margins are tight, and you want the opportunities to race in that four shoot race, especially if your shooting is your stronger event.
Yeah, absolutely. Palm, Tudor Palm, 92, bib 92, that is 82nd position. He's only missed one, but it's an introduction to World Cup racing. It's a tough time. It's always a tough time. Be brought into team for World Cup. Yes, his first ever World Cup. Has been performing well. He's only 20. And it's a tough, it's a hard day. And getting the last group and the poorest conditions, all biathletes know you have to just take what you get in terms of your bib number. The coaches will normally direct it, which group you're going in.
That is true, yeah. You've got a fight to earn, and I think the coaches take it into account. If you get a similar result compared to someone who is in a faster group, then, you know, you're given the credit of that, at least in terms of giving the opportunity to move into a better group for the next race.
Absolutely right. The coaches are all from Racing Stock. The faces on the firing point or scoping, all ex-biathletes. You have to know your trade well. And actually, that broken pin from Johannes Tingesbø, the backup in that Norwegian team, that was Formula One.
That is true, yeah. You wouldn't get that in every team. Certainly most of the teams will be used to it. No one will hope it's going to happen. But for some of the teams, it would have been a case of quickly zero the spare rifle and race with that, which you never really want to do.
So true. Chevenka racing, Vaclav Chevenka racing for America. He's philosophical. He knows that missing four, he's not going to make the top 60. He certainly would have had the shooting been one or less. He'd have been well up the field. 23:55.9. And significantly, Johannes Tingesbø with that time, 48.1 ahead of his older brother. And great to see Tarjebo back at the races. And the problem for Johannes Tingesbø is Sturla Holm Lagrid is still in third.
Once again, just won't go away, will he? But I think there's something happening with Lagrid, Mike. He didn't look great today. I don't think he found this race... he doesn't find any races easy, but I think there's something not quite right with Lagrid, and we'll see. I even have a suspicion we may see him do worse tomorrow.
I wonder. Sometimes you think you get back into it. You mentioned it's at 1,320 metres here. It's the height of this venue is the height of the top of Ben Nevis, and you fill a bottle up there, an empty 1 litre bottle. By the time you're down at sea level in Fort William, that bottle has crushed quite a lot. It's amazing. I've been up there 66 times. And so, you know, the altitude here, there is less air, so maybe it's an altitude thing with him having gone down low back home into Norway for the Christmas break.
Quite possibly. But the difficulty is, the option you have is go somewhere high to train over Christmas, but then that starts to affect your end of season performance because it's such a long winter and you start to lose, it becomes a war of attrition, just a case of hanging in there, and you don't enjoy the racing anymore. You don't enjoy the traveling, you don't have any camaraderie, you just want it to all end.
Yeah. And it was interesting as we look at top 60 is 323. Patrick Juks from Latvia is there, so he gets a start tomorrow. All these athletes don't. Yes, it is tough, and it was interesting, no hugs and discussion about the race afterwards between Johannes Tingesbo and Ligrid. They're good, they're good friends, there's no big grudge there, but they're pushing each other to the limit, or Ligrid is certainly pushing Johannes Tingesbo to great things, as Martin Fourcade did three, four seasons ago. So the proceedings coming to a close here in Pokljuka, and Johannes Tingesbo at the top once again.
Johannes, congratulations. This was an absolutely phenomenal performance on skis. One miss in the prone, but you kept it cool. How do you rate this performance? Really, we don't have words.
I think it was almost a perfect race. I think close to shooting clean in prone as well. During this week of training, it has been very good, and standing especially. So I was quite confident coming in for the standing shooting, but I was seeing Sturla shooting clean, and for sure he put the pressure on you. but good skis, fast shooting, happy.
Have you felt any better on skis than today?
I don't know. I think I found the very right speed today. If you ski a little bit too hard here, your legs are burning. So after the first message on the track, I pushed the brakes. I was skiing too fast from the start, and I think today the Waxmen, they made, yeah, during my whole career, this is probably top three skis I've skied on.
But you made them go fast as well, so congratulations.
Yes, I did, but for sure it helps.
Congrats.
Thanks.
Medalje i priznanja Gosta Padelina, gospod Jerzy Kamza, podpredsednik IBU-ja, in pa gospod Jelko Kacin, predsednik organizacijskega odbora Pokljuka. Ladies and gentlemen, the presses and the flowers and the prices of the organizers. Applaus, Johannes Tiefen!